Good morning, everybody. My name is Eran Keltz. I'm an orthopedic trauma surgeon from Rambam Healthcare Campus in Haifa, Israel. And I'm about to share our experience with a new technique we've developed to perform preoperative planning for intramedullary nailing of the tibia using contralateral x-rays of the healthy leg. This method was initiated by my colleague, Dr. Ido Stahl, and we have some very good experience with it, as I'm about to share, and also was published in the literature. I have nothing to disclose. Now, tibia diaphyseal fractures are highly prevalent, and about 26 to 100,000 cases, and we can see that the relatively younger age of 37 years old of those patients is explained by the relatively higher energy you need for these fractures. Also, the male to female ratio is about 3 to 1, also explained by that energy. Now we can use these, we can treat these fractures conservatively using circular casts or even patellar bearing casts, but it's highly common to operate these fractures. We have several options, but the most common one in my institute is intramedullary nailing due to its minimal invasive nature and the possibility to allow, due to its stability, to allow for early weight bearing and mobilization. So why is it so important to plan ahead and have a nail at the right measurement? If we use a nail that is too long, we might cause destruction of the fracture sites and even non-union, or we can cause malreduction of the fracture site and malunion or non-union. If we over-sink in it, we might penetrate the tibial plafond, or if we're not sinking it enough, we can cause irritation of the patellar tendon. If the nail is too short, its lever arm might not be sufficient for stability, or it might be oversunk, and which may pose difficulties, technical difficulties, to extract the nail later on if needed. If the nail is too thick, we will over-rim the tibia and will weaken the bone and may cause iatrogenic fractures. And if the nail is too thin, the principle of load sharing will not be addressed and will have insufficient stability, which may pose problems. Needless to say that the interlocking screws, if they are too proud, they might cause soft tissue irritation, and we can see that from it's occasionally patients that demand to extract those screws later on, so we wish to avoid that. There are several methods in the literature published as far as preoperative planning addressing the measurements of the nail. Most of them are anthropometric measurement, such as the knee joint to ankle joint distance, the knee joint to the medial malleolus distance, the tibial tuberosity to the medial malleolus distance, and the olecranon to the head of the fifth metatarsal distance. There are several formulations of these methods and even combined. But the results are not as accurate as we would want them to be. We have also techniques that involve fluoroscopy, either preoperatively or intraoperatively. We can use the manufacturer's ruler or templates inside the surgical field. Rami Moshaev had suggested the use of a Kremer splint as a calibration method. And we use sometimes the nail in the box method. We take the sterile nail just before draping the patient, and we use fluoroscopy to see that the nail is fitting before we drape the patient and open the sterility of the nail. Now, this is a review that was published in Injury in 2012 by Galbraith, and you can see that the accuracy of those anthropometric measurement, especially the one I published preoperatively, are not that accurate. We see between 50 to 80, 79% accuracy, sometimes a bit more, but sometimes much less. And this is not sufficient for us to have the security that we can open the correct nail. So in our study, what we've done, we took 27 volunteers that we operated for tibial diaphyseal fractures with intramedullary nailing. And in the post-op time, they volunteered to have their healthy leg x-rayed. And we used the standard 25 millimeter calibration ball, and the beam of the x-ray was centered at the middle of the diaphysis. And we took six surgeons, three consultants, and three senior residents, and they were given the task to use the TraumaCad software to perform preoperative planning of the healthy leg and establish the nail measurements, length, diameter, and the distal locking screws. They did it twice using both AP and lateral views separately. And they were blinded from the surgical methods. All they knew is the manufacturer of the nail, so they would use a nail from the same portfolio of the same manufacturer, but that's it. On a different occasion, we asked them to review post-extractum the surgical results, to have a look at the x-rays, and view their opinion whether the nail that was actually used was proper, or they would do something differently, use an end cap, use a longer, shorter, thicker, thinner nail, and rank that, and establish what would be the ideal nail they would have used ex post factum, given the surgical results. And we analyzed that. We used the ICC variable to establish inter-observer reliability when for the preoperative planning, both to the AP planning and the lateral view planning, and for the distal locking screws that naturally you can use either one of them to measure the AP screw or the medial lateral screws. And we analyzed the intra-observer reliability between the planning using the AP view and the lateral view with the same examiner. And we compared what they planned using the healthy leg preoperative plan and what they would use as the ideal nail, we call it the calculated corrected nail, and to see the match there with the same examiner. So the results were quite stunning. We see that an ICC of 0.75 and higher is considered to be excellent. And we see that the inter-observer reliability using both the AP view planning and the lateral view planning, both in diameter and even higher with length of the nail, is above 0.85, which is excellent. So this method is highly consistent among the examiners. We saw less excellent results, but still considered very good as far as the locking screws, especially the AP screw, which the ICC was 0.9, but also with the medial lateral screws. We see that the result of 0.7 with the proximal one of the two we explained it that it's located in the flare of the tibia just before the tibial plafond. So a minor change in the nail location might cause a significant change in the measurement of that screw. That's our explanation to this phenomenon. The inter-observer reliability between the calculated nail and what they planned was also very, very good. I mean, that we have six examiners, and they all agreed what would be the corrected nail, what would be the ideal nail. I mean, I'm talking 0.96 ICC, which is almost perfect. And it's not to be taken lightly, because in about 30% of the cases, they would change something ex post factum. They would take a longer nail that was used or a thicker nail, and they all made the same changes. They all had the same idea, so they agreed what would be the ideal nail in almost 100% of the cases. And another, now we go to the intra-observer reliability. We see that there is no difference between the planning we use in the AP view and the lateral view. We suggest that using either view is sufficient. You don't need to do that twice, even though it's quite easy, with a slight advantage to the lateral views. And when we examine what would be the match between the same examiner, you see the six examiners at the bottom, what would be the match between what the examiner planned using the healthy leg preoperative planning and what he would use when he reviewed the surgical result as the ideal nail, we see that we have very good intra-observer reliability concerning the nail length and slightly less concerning the diameter. We explained that when we use a 10 millimeter diameter, each millimeter we change in percentage is much higher than changing 15 millimeters in a 34 centimeter nail length. So the relative change is higher in diameter and it's harder to establish a correct diameter in those nails, but still the ICC is considered good between 0.6 and 0.8. When we discuss these results, we see that actually preoperative planning is highly valuable to us because we want to minimize the surgical time and the derived complications such as bleeding and infection. We want to reduce the X-ray dose in fluoroscopy, both for the patient and for the OR team. We reduce the likelihood for surgical gross errors and opening sterile equipment unnecessarily. And we ensure that we have the proper equipment on shelf before surgery. We suggest that we can use this method also to perform debriefing post-factum. We can, for staff meeting or for if we want to have a Q&A meeting, we can use this method for debriefing. So in conclusion, we've shown that digital preoperative planning of tibial diaphyseal fractures using the healthy contralateral leg is a highly reproducible, reliable method, especially concerning the length of the nail, slightly less with the diameter and slightly less with the interlocking screws. And we've shown that using just a single X-ray, either AP or lateral, with small advantage, insignificant advantage to the lateral view, is sufficient and reliable. And we highly recommend this method for preoperative planning of tibial diaphyseal fracture operations. Okay, I'll demonstrate a short case. We have this patient with a right diaphyseal tibia fibula fracture. He also has a medial malleolus fracture, as you can see here. So we took X-rays of the contralateral leg and imported it into the TraumaCad software. So this is the lateral view, and I click also the AP view, and I click next, select the trauma option here, and now I have to calibrate those images. So you can see that the lateral view is outlined with red circumference. This is a left leg, and you can see an auto calibration using the calibration ball. It's done automatically, but I can also perform manual calibration if I have something to anchor on. I'll repeat the same phase using the AP view. And now I select the anatomical location of the left diaphyseal tibia and import the template of the nail I use. I use here a striker nail, a T2 standard nail, but I can also use, if I want, the implants from the recently used category, so I can go to what I know and what I've used in the past. I usually select a common length and diameter that I use and locate the nail. It's easier to start from the entry point, which is a more fixed anchor site for me. the axis of rotation is the red dot. It's easier to control it from the distal side. And I recognize that 11 millimeters might be too much, could cause over-rimming, so I'll take a 10 millimeter nail. The length seems appropriate. I can try to use a longer nail, and I see that it's too long. It endangers the tibial plafond, so I would settle for the 33 centimeter nail. And I would add also the locking screws. So I select here the screws, and the screws I want, and locate the screw. It's quite easy to, locate and to control the length. Just stretch it to the correct length I want. And now I'll just copy that implant for another medial lateral screw, slightly longer. You can also elongate it here. And I want another AP screw, so I will copy the implant, but now I need to transpose it from AP to lateral, so it would be planned in the lateral view here. Seems fair enough. Maybe a bit shorter, and we're good to go. Now I choose the report, and I can preview the report or just show it here and even export it into the PAC system to be saved. This is the technical report. You can see in both views, and you have all the technical data here, all the numbers, and we can compare it to the surgical results, what we've done de facto. You can see also the medial malleolus fixation using the cannulated screws, and the results are quite matching. So this takes only 3 to 5 minutes and can save you a lot of time and energy and radiation. So good luck with that. Thank you.